Alright, so we're going to read Marvel Fox. Not all of it. Maybe like the first three chapters. So got it right here. I used to really like Brian Jacques's works in the Redwall world growing up. They were like my favorite books. May he rest in peace. He was a big influence on me, and I've been thinking about writing fiction for younger kids, so this will be good for me to reread, because I haven't read them since I was like 12, 14 years ago. So, like, I read them before I was 12, but like 12 was probably when I got kind of out of them a little bit, like by I reached middle school. And I had a bunch of them, but the only two I kept, as far as, like, not put away, I got rid of a lot of them, unfortunately, but, I have some stored away, but I got these two, still here, The Outcast of Redwall and Marvel Fox. And if you don't know what Redwall is, it's just, little animals. And they have, like, a, you know, a society. So it's anthropomorphic animals, but they're, like, shrunk down still. So, like, they don't mention humans, really, but they're all, like, in this weird scale. I'm actually gonna get some water first. Let me mute this, and then everyone will catch up, and I'll be right back. Yeah, my dog just left the room. Alright, I'm back. Got some snacks. Got some water. Got some Turkey Hill green tea. This is like my one vice in life. Like, I do have a pipe, but I barely smoke it. Like, twice a year, maybe. I don't smoke cigarettes, I don't smoke weed, I don't really drink alcohol. On occasion, I do. But that Turkey Hill stuff, I drink a lot, and it's terrible for me. It's, like, full of sugar and shit, but, it's kind of the one thing I let myself have. Like, I don't really even drink soda that much. Like, the time I go to get soda is, like, when I'm at a restaurant, I'll order soda sometimes. I had it last night. I had some Coke. But, like, with the green tea, I try to drink, like, I want water to water. My room's really not that messy. But you're seeing, like, back there, like, I'll show you. My bed is here, so it's just my bed. And then this is my hamper. Like this thing. That's just like, that's my clothes hamper. It has dirty clothes in it. Like that's just my blankets. My bed's just not made. But my room's really not dirty. Or like cluttered or anything. There's some dust, but I can show you. Like there's that. We got some TP. It smells like fragrancy. But yeah, it's really not messy or cluttered. And there's that side over there. And I like to keep turning. It's a bad idea because my light's gonna hook up, so let's not do that. Alright, I'll plug it. There we go. There's my bookcase. So, like, it's not really dirty. Like, cluttery or anything. Pretty minimal as far as, like, physical crap goes. Yeah. You know, the Turkey Hill stuff, Alley? I don't really know if that's, like, a national thing or not. Let's try and work on this lighting, shall we? That's good. That makes me look, like, semi-decent. That's not bad lighting. Alright, is V4 back yet? Do I know some dust is? Some of it's hair. Like, my dog's always sleeping on my bed. I see he knocked the blanket down with him. Well, the TP actually was, Caroline was here and she had like a sinus infection, so she was just blowing her nose. I forgot to put it away. But honestly, it kind of can be emergency TP, because my sister always goes to the bathroom and never replaces it. So if I go in there and I don't want to go all the way downstairs, it's like right there. So it's good to have a secret roll in your room, so you avoid that nastiness. I'm waiting for V4 to return, then I'll start reading. I don't know where Steven went. Minimum physical stuff, maximum digital stuff. I'm a digital junkie. A data hoarder. Like, I'll download a bunch of ebooks I'll never read just to have them. It's like, I'm never gonna read these. I have a huge collection of ebooks I'm never gonna touch. I got every single NES game for some reason. So shit like that, I just like to collect. I used to collect a lot of just internet pictures, but that hard drive crashed, so. Yeah. Let's see, the back just says, a grand adventure, breathtaking. No beast living can hide from thee, O thou who treads invisibly. Cross hill and vale, through woods and rocks, Morrow Fox, Morrow Fox, Morrow Fox. And, like, these books, I can remember being excited for them when they came out. Especially the other one I have, The Outcast Redwall. I was hyped as shit waiting for that to come out. Now I'm actually going to look up on my phone when it did, because I'm curious. Let's see. The Outcast of Redwall.
According to Wikipedia, Outcast of Redwall is a 1995 fantasy novel by Brian Jacques.
1995? That can't, I guess that's right. I mean, it's right that came out, but I'm thinking of a different book then. Because one of his later ones, I was like really excited waiting for it to come out. Let's see. Was Morrow Fox the later one then? I remember being a kid and it was like, oh, Brian Jacques' new book. Coming out. No, Morrow Fox came out and what am I thinking of? I know what I'm thinking of. The Tiger Run, which came out in 2001. So. That was the one, like, I had read the others, and, I got hyped. That makes sense, because all these other ones that came out after, I never read. So. Right. Yeah, that makes sense. Must have been the Tageron. Did I get rid of the Tageron then? Man, I hope I didn't. I might have gotten rid of the Tageron, you guys. That was a good book. I like that book. The Tageron. I gotta look for it. Man. I had hoped that I found it. I mean, I hope I find it. You're curious about my books? Like, what, who's that behind me? Obama? You guys keep seeing people behind me, or shadows, or something. It's spooky. Like, what do you care about my books for? And, Allie, not so much porn as weird, like, old internet crap. Like, vintage net shit that unfortunately don't have anymore. Yeah, that's an original Obama poster. The lane looks really good down here. I wish I could, can I edit these? Like, the chop off right before, like, I actually start reading? For anyone else that would ever watch this for some reason after I'm done streaming? No, I don't know. Like, you're curious about the books I've written before? Or what? Or, like, my book collection in general? Because I don't have a big physical book collection. And I'm really, I read a lot more comics than I do longer prose, which is bad of me. But I got into that habit more so during and after college. So, like high school, middle school, and stuff, I was always reading like books, and then I don't know why I got more into comics as I got older. Because I'm a fucking man-child, I don't know what to tell you before. I'll start reading, though. We can read, like, the first, chapter. Maybe first two or three. Because I think they are... pretty short chapters. They're, like, 10-page chapters. Let's see, up to chapter 4 is how long? Pages will be up to chapter 4. So, I mean, that'll probably time me out pretty well. Let's see, Act 1, Enter the Players, and we got this map. You see, we got a map of the world. You don't read fantasy. I mean, I still don't know if you're asking about like my stuff or these books, because I don't know. Let me know, and then I can. Oh, you know, I mostly read, like, fantasy stuff. I got, my small book collection is just a really, really small collection. And it's, like, these, two of these, a Tom Clancy book. I got a couple detective books. I got a book on, like, samurai history. A book of, like, Zen quotes. Dracula and like a nice Barnes & Noble cover, white jacket. The Invisible Man, but not H.G. Wells, the Ralph Ellison one. I got Jurassic Park, I have Inherent Vice. Like, for a while, and in college, I would, like, get a book, and then I would, we had, like, Goodwill used to have really good book selection, now it's, like, really shitty. But I would go, and you would pay, like, 50 cents for a book, and then I would just take it back and donate it. Or actually, there was this bank right near me. And they have, like, a little bookshelf inside the bank, and I didn't have an account there, but you could go in there, and you could drop off books, and they could, take books. So, I did that for a while. When I got rid of a bunch of books a few years ago, I brought them all there. And they were happy. I'm gonna drop them there. And, like, my desk is just, you know, I got my first dog's ashes on here. I got, like, a soup bowl from Caroline. Got a bunch of Caro stuff on here. You're curious about the genre, like, this genre? Fantasy? I mean, should I just get to it? Are you guys ready? Are you guys ready for the Marvel Fox? Give it a shot. So it begins, throughout there's this, Brian Jacques, like, he loves writing about food, and he'll call him Vittles a lot. I mean, I am trying to read the chat, I'm just kind of, sort of misunderstanding. I don't know. So Brian Jacques loves writing about food, and he also has a bunch of songs and poems. They're very common. So you'll be hearing a lot about food and probably a bunch of songs. And it's been a really long time since I read this, so we shall enjoy it. It begins with a poem, though. This is even before chapter one starts. And then there's a prologue. So there's a poem, there's a prologue, and then chapter one actually starts. To where will they go? This is a secret no beast may know. Marl Fox. Plundering, murdering, vulpine thieves who blend with stone or meld with leaves. Marl Fox. See the pale eyes and swirling cloak. A pair like nightmare vanish like smoke. Marl Fox. What steals upon the silent air, gleaming fangs, mottled fur, a deadly axe blade lying there, Marl Fox. No beast living can hide from thee, O thou who treads invisibly, across hill and vale, through woods and rocks, Marl Fox, Marl Fox, Marl Fox. So, that's the opening poem. Here's the prologue. Who are we but strolling players, wandering through the long ago? Joys and sadness, hopes and longings, keeps us traveling onward though. The laughter and applause of others who view the passing cavalcade leave echoes hovering, some far summer, floating round the woodland glade. 'Twas but a tale for your amusement, like my small and worthy rhyme. Gone, alas, into those realms, the land of once upon a time. Act 1, enter the players. And there's a nice illustration there. I'm still upset that I lost a Tangerang. I gotta look for that. Well, I'm glad you're interested, V4. This is chapter one, and there's another little illustration. And I don't know if Brian Jacques did the illustrations himself or not. Let's see.
Cover art by Troy Howell, hand lettering by Iskra Johnson. Doesn't say the inside.
Anyway, chapter 1. Eternally serene, the moon ruled over star-strewn vaults of cloudless sable night, like a round shield of flecked amber, casting pale light to the earth below. Vagrant breezes from the distant sea drifted idly through Mossflower's Wood's southwest margins, cooling the heavy warmth a bright summer day had left in its wake. Jangler Swifteye sat at the edge of a well-worn trail, his back against the broad trunk of a fallen elm, savoring the calm summer night. He was an unusual squirrel, half as tall again as most his species, with dark terracotta fur, untypically long and thick. A huge bush of fur added to the impression of his size. Beneath the fur, Jangler's limbs were hefty and robust, with a stomach of considerable girth, which his mother constantly chided him about. His eyes were hooded and long-lashed, giving the impression he was always half asleep. However, any beast who knew Jangler Swifteye was careful not to be fooled by his air of easygoing idleness. He was renowned as a quick and dangerous warrior, immensely strong and wise in the ways of battle. But there was another side to him. He was also an obedient son, a dutiful husband, and a fond father. In the woodlands behind him, his family slept in their little traveling tent. His mother, Elio, his wife, Rimrose, and Songbreeze, the daughter who was the apple of her father's eye. From beneath half-closed lids, Jangler Swifteye watched, missing nothing. Clusters of flowering dock nodded lightly against gnarled oaks' trunks. Orange-berried arums and spiking-flowered sedge swayed lazily between elder chestnut and sycamore trees. Nocturnal insects trundled, or wings or various ways, through the darkened forest. He has really long sentences. From somewhere deep in the thickets, a nightingale warbled its short, rich trill. Jangler whistled a reply to it on its reed flute, aware that some beast was creeping up behind him. The only move he made was to blink away a midge from his eyelashes. He knew who the intruder was by the way she approached, and Jangler chuckled. "I hear ye, missy, couldn't sleep, eh?" His daughter Songbreeze climbed slowly over the elm trunk and slid down beside him. "No beast could ever surprise you, old Swifteye. Phew. It's far too hot to sleep, and Grandma's snoring like a score of hedgehogs after a feast." Jangler winked lazily at her. "Huh. Listen, who's talking? You should have heard yourself snoring some nights, drowning your poor grandma's poor efforts out completely." She shoved her father playfully. "I do not. Young squirrel mates do not snore. Ask Mum." Jangler snorted softly. "Your mother's worse than both of you put together." The nightingale warbled a short melody again. Jangler picked up his reed flute. "Listen to that feller. Thinks he can sing. Come on now, show him." No creature who knew the tall, pretty squirrel ever used her full name. Jangler played a brief introduction, then Song's voice rang with such sweetness and clarity that a tear coursed its way down her father's cheek. Her voice never failed to move him. And she sings. "Flowers of the forest, ape bright in the spring, wake with the dawn, hear a lone skylark sing, brooks gaily babble, over hillsides so green, streams ripple secrets of what they have seen. Small birds give voice mid the leaves of great trees, which rustle softly in the time with the breeze. I'll add my music for what it's worth, and sing just for you, love, the song of the earth." As the last plaintive notes died, Jangler put aside his flute and wiped a paw quickly across his eyes. Song nudged him gently. "Big tough warrior, eh? Crying again?" Her father sniffled aloud, looking away from her. "Don't be silly. 'Twas just a midge in my eye." They keep saying midge. "'Twas just a midge in me eye, but I couldn't play for you and wipe it out at the same time. Had to wait till you were finished singing." In another part of the woodland, two foxes ceased their prowl through the undergrowth and listened to the sweet, plaintive melody floating faintly on the night air. Both beasts were identical. Apart from the fact that they were brother and sister, they were liked in every other aspect. Askarad and his sister Vanin were marl foxes, pale-eyed with strange silver-white coats, heavily mottled with patches of black and blue-gray. They wore swirling coats of drab brown and green weave. Askarad's lip scarcely moved as he muttered to his sister, "That singer warbles more sweetly than any bird I ever heard." Vanin's pale eyes glimmered in the moonlight. "Aye, brother, and would trill even better at the court of our mother, Queen Silth. Come on." In the space of breath, both marl foxes were gone, melted back into the night-shaded forest like tendrils on the smoke of the wind. Song plucked a blade of grass and tickled her father's ear tip. Big old softy, come on and play a lively tune. I'll put a smile back on your face, eh? Yeah, 'twas just a midge. It's really weird. A midge? What the fuck is a midge? I don't know. But Jangler was not paying attention to her. He stiffened, both ears twitching as he sniffed the breeze. Song caught the urgency of his mood. What is it? Can you hear something? Jangler's hooded eyes flickered. He watched the trees on the opposite side of the path, talking quietly, not looking at his daughter as he continued scanning the woodlands. Go quick to your mama, Song, and tell her I can't be silent, and stay put, hurry now. Song had seen her father like this before. She knew better than to stop and argue with him. Wordlessly, she slipped away to the tent. Jangler took a dangerous-looking thorn dot, tufted with dried glass from his belt patch. Placing the missile in his mouth, he tucked it against one cheek and sat back against the elm trunk. Idly, he began playing his reed flute. Outwardly, the big squirrel appeared calm, but inside he was poised like lightning, ready to strike. In a short while, he made out the two foxes moving expertly from a patch of ferns to the cover of some bushes, coming closer to him by the moment. Jangler took the flute from his lips, calling out sternly, "Quit sneaking about and walk on the path like decent creatures." Askarad and Vanin had thought the squirrel was unaware of their approach. They hid their surprise by putting on a bold front. Swaggering up to where Jangler sat, Askarad kicked the squirrel's footpaw, just hard enough to warn him that he and his sister were well in charge of the situation. "You there! You who was singing a while ago?" Jangler did not bother to look up at Askarad, though his voice was menacingly low. "None of your business, Snipe Nose. Now get going and take the other one with ye." Vanin winked at her brother and smiled nastily at her as her paw began to stray toward the single-bladed axe she carried beneath her cloak. Jangler appeared to ignore them and went back to playing his flute. Askarad leaned close to the squirrel, baring his teeth. Louder? Okay. I'm trying to be quiet because it's midnight here now, so... "You're very insolent for a fat, lazy squirrel. Shall I show you what we do to beasts with such insulting tongues?" Pfft. Jangler's swift eye shot the dart from his flute, burying it deep in the tip of Askarad's nose. As the fox shrieked out in agony, Jangler sprang upright. Whipping forth a loaded sling from his waist, he hurled himself upon Vanin, who had her axe halfway out. She went down in an unconscious heap as the hard oval river pebbles in the sling's tongues thwacked heavily across her skull. Askarad was hop-skipping about wildly. Both paws clapped his muzzle as he screeched with pain. "Eek! Yareek! Tails and scuts preserve us all. Who's kicking up that awful din?" Shaken with anger, Jangler turned to see his family dashing toward him with LLO in the lead, brandishing a blackthorn stick. Jangler stared accusingly at his daughter. "Song, I thought I told you to stay put and keep him quiet." There are squirrels and foxes. One of the characters is, there's like a squirrel family and they're being attacked by two foxes right now. Rimnose placed herself between them. "'Twern't no fault of Song's. You just try and stop that old mama of yours when she starts swinging that stick." Jangler's paw shot out. He caught the tip of his mother's stick and held it tight. Heaving on the black thorn and stumbling on her long apron hem, the old squirrel wife berated her son. Lego me sticky grape butter belly tree walloper Lego or I spank 10 seasons daylights out of ye. Song giggled and clapped her paws. That's the stuff, Grandma. You give him a good spanking. Rimrose wagged a paw at her daughter. That'll be quite enough of that, Missy. Show some proper respect for your elders. Then, unable to prevent herself, she fell against Song, laughing helplessly. Oh, hee hee hee. It'd be a funny sight to see your grandma giving that great lump a spank or two. Hee hee. Grandma Elalo let go of the stick and turned on Song and Rimrose, attempting to look fierce as she hid a smile. Ha! Don't you two think I couldn't tan his veil if I took a mind to it? I'm still his mother, you know. Jangler lifted his mother clear of the ground, hugging her fondly. You can scalp the fur off of me any time you want, my lovely old bark belter. Why, I bet you could. Song interrupted suddenly. Look, the foxes are gone. All that remained of the Marl Fox's visit was a few drops of blood from Asgard's muzzle, glistening darkly amid the disturbed dust of the path. Jangler peered into the dark woodlands. Aye, they've got away somehow. Won't catch them now that they've vanished. He put a paw on his daughter's shoulders. Mark what I say, Song. They're Marl Foxes. Strange blood runs in their veins. They can disappear like no other living creature. Come on, ladies, we best break camp and get traveling. Jangler's family had been wanderers since he was in his infancy, and breaking camp was a simple affair to them. Once the canvas they used for a tent had been folded, their few cooking implements were rolled into the form of a backpack. In the pre-dawn light, they breakfasted on a clear stream water and a traveling fruit and honey cake that Rimrose had baked 2 days before. Grandma, what's a Marl Fox? Asked Song between mouthfuls. Elalo tried to explain. It's a really weird name. Elio tried to explain. The story goes back a long ways. 'Tis far too long to tell in short time. But I'll tell you thee this much, Missy. Somewhere there's a forgotten lake, a great stretch of deep water, almost an inland sea, some beasts say. That's where the Marl Foxes live, and the most cunning of them all, if she still lives there, is Queen Sylph. Aye, they call her the most powerful magical creature alive. 'Tis said her island is a place of great riches and beauty. I heard all this from a poor creature who was set upon a bunch of magpies while fishing off the island. Elio fell silent, and Jangler said, Don't bother your grandma further, Song. If Marl Foxes are loose in the land, you may learn more than you bargained for. Pick up that linen now, we need to be traveling. Northeast in touch, I reckon. Song folded the small tablecloth which she had embroidered herself. What lies in that direction, father? Jangler shouldered the tent pack, settling it with comfort on his back. The Abbey of Redwall. The young squirrel maiden's eyes grew wide with delight. She had never visited there, though she had heard tales of the fabulous place. Redwall Abbey? How wonderful. Oh, Mama, will it be as nice as you told me when I was little? Rimrose smiled at her daughter's excitement. Even nicer, I imagine. Words cannot fully describe a place like Redwall. Song took Grandma Elio's paw, supporting her as they walked. With Jangler in the lead, they set off as dawn was breaking. It promised to be another hot summer day, but the tree canopy was thick and would shade them as the sun rose higher. Song could not resist a final question to her father. Why are we going to Redwall? Jangler tucked the reed flute into his broad belt. Because we must warn whoever rules at that abbey that there are Marl Foxes roaming the land. And that's chapter one. Questions so far. Gonna have some water. Oh man, I have an old. Oh wow. I got like a really old, like a library card, I guess. That was in here. I don't know why, because I bought this book. Not like a rented book. That's been used as a bookmark a long time ago. Expires June 2003. Look at that, that's cool. I think I'll use that as the bookmark. Why not? I was going to use this business card, but, Always that. Makes me wonder what I had in the other books. Respond to a text real quick. Yeah, he is a very descriptive writer. I'm terrible at that. Allie, I should send you the book I wrote in January, because it's a lot better than one you got. And I'll send it to you if you give me your email. Send me like an email on Discord. Actually, I think I can just send you the PDF on Discord, actually. I'm still not a very good descriptive writer. But, I'm trying to somewhat. I don't know. I'm bad at description. I need to be a screenwriter, in all honesty. I think that's, like, where my strengths are. So, we'll start, chapter 2. Let me have one of these. These are peanut butter, tasty cakes. They're quite good. Oh, my God. I'll eat the next one after I'm done the next chapter. It'll be a reward for reading. Yay! Yeah, Allie, it's about as long as Little Wonder is. It's a little bit shorter, but... I think it's much better than Little Wonder is. Even though it's completely different. There's no sci-fi really in it, except for one chapter has a little, without spoiling it too much. It's mostly not sci-fi. It's like a mobster story set in 1990. Yeah, some people are really good at description, and then some people less so. Like, I read some Tom Clancy growing up, and I still have one. And he described a lot in, like, super, super detail. Yeah, shoved the whole thing right into my mouth. Anyway, I can send you that, Allie, if you're interested, because I know you like to read things. So you said before. So, chapter 2. Here we go. Little illustration. They're not Reese's. They have peanut butter in them, but they're not Reese's. It's like a little sponge cake with a little layer of peanut butter on top, and then it's all engrossed in chocolate. It's a local thing. It's East Coast, but where I'm at, it's like a Philly, Jersey, Delaware thing. They're not everywhere. Chapter 2, then. So I'm gonna have another sip of water. Like, after realizing I was streaming for, like, 3 hours, and then talking during that and talking now. Voice is getting tired. But we shall continue. Can you guys hear me alright? Because V4 said to speak louder, so I got a little bit closer. Farther south on the flatlands, close to the woodland fridge, a gaily painted cart stood propped straight on its two large wheels. It had a single shaft, cross-thread at the end by a well-worn pushing bar. Stretched over willow hoops and a canvas cover was copiously painted in once bright colors, now faded by sun and seasons, though the lettering still read clearly, "The Sensational Wandering Noonvale Companions Troop." On the nearby stream bank, a motley collection of creatures were preparing for a rehearsal. One of them, a theatrical-looking hare, stood forward. He was clad in a rumpled frock coat of lilac silk and a wide-brimmed straw hat, though his enormous ears poked. He wore a floppy yellow blue... It's so silly. He wore floppy yellow boots and carried a silver-tipped cane. The hare's outfit had obviously seen better seasons, as the cart and the entire troop had. Nevertheless, the hare twirled his cane and boomed out in fine, dramatic fashion, as if addressing a vast audience. "Good morrow, one and all. I am Florian Duggerwolf, Wufflechop, Hiram Preshiar and Hochder and Manjar. I present the Sensational Wandering Noonvale Companions Troop, descendants of a talented tradition, unrivaled throughout the entire land. Death-defying feats, hilarious comical plays, music and magical virtuosity, jocular gigs and delightful dancing. Come one, come all, witness our mellifluously marvelous, perfectly pleasurable educational entertainment, entirely free of charge." He smiled winningly and continued in a loud stage whisper. "Homemade cakes, pastries, and sundry cosmetables, purely for the nourishment of the artists, gladly accepted with profuse thanks." From the cover of the cart, a gruff voice interrupted Florian's speech impatiently. "Oh, go on with it, a forest fall sheep." And he writes things very, like, "Oh, get on with it." And I love the way he writes. That might be a vole or a mole. I don't know yet. He would always write the mole's language in like a very strange way, and it was very, very funny. So yeah, let's see what that is. If they see what it is. The hare shot an outraged glance at the cart and snorted. Turning back to his imaginary audience, he beamed. "And now, my bucolic friends, good wives and rustic spouses..." Not forget, I got the hiccups. "And now, my bucolic friends, good wives and rustic spouses, not forgetting your charming youngins, we reach our finale. The very climax of our prodigious performance. Baroque Iron Chest and Eclem Okpaw, the strongest hotters ever born, with attempt at daring displays of muscle power. With him himself, he'd seen 10 other lesser beasts. If you had known of dangerous, nervous nature, to kindly look away and swoon in and faint in and may distract the hardest attention, these two mighty marvels will lifting higher, high repeat the entire, disregarding me good self, of course, they will lift the entire wandering Noonvale Companions troop off the ground." Two burly otters, wearing tawdry gold-fringed pantaloons, skipping athletically forward, flexing their muscles and bowing, puffing forth their chest and showing rows of white teeth and daredevil smiles. They performed a few limbering up exercises, then went about their business, seizing both ends of a long wooden bench. They started with a great show of huffing and puffing to lift. Standing on the bench were two moles. Moles. One dressed in a spangled red bloomers, the other in a cloak and a turban of jade green. Alliteration is, well, I'm sure Allie will answer before I actually answer, but if you had, like, the same letter in a sentence over and over again, so, like, let's see, in there. It was there. I'm trying to think where it was.
Can't find it. I like the Hector stuff, the H over and over again, sort of.
But if you're like, the big brown bear bounced, that type of thing. Yeah, Allie's apples are all amazing. The dog danced delightfully down the driveway. Something like that. I love alliteration for some reason. I always really liked it. We shall continue. Lying gracefully across the heads of two moles was a mouse wearing a coronet of imitation flowers and a flowing sky blue gown. Skillfully perched on one paw placed upon the mouse's midriff, a hedgehog balanced precariously, his spikes tipped with a mass of pennant, small flags, and bunting. Up, up went the bench, and with all aboard it, wobbling perilously. The hare, Florian, muttered encouragement in a loud stage whisper. Keep it going up, chaps, that's the ticket. Every beast remains still now. Hold ye positions. Up she goes. What? Burricule and Elichim grunted and strained artistically until they finally lifted the bench over their heads. Suddenly, Burricule gave out a tremendous bellow. Yowooch. He released his hold on the bench and grabbed his rear. Amid howls of dismay, the troop and the bench came to earth in jumbled disarray. Florian dashed forward, furious. Down on all fours, he berated Borocule, who lay trapped by the bench, still clutching his bottom. Great seasons, oh sausages, you blithering, bang-tailed buffoon. That's another one. Blithering, bang-tailed buffoon. Why did you let the bally bench drop? Crimson-faced, Borocule gasped. Because that... that's great. Because that perishing mouse babe shot me with a sling stone. Florian Dugglewolf Whiffleclop. Which is also a fucking great name. Florian Dugglewolf Whifflechop. Drew himself to his full height, ears twitching and teeth grinding audibly. Oh ho, he did he? Well, 'tis high time I had a serious encounter with that blistering, undersized miscreant. Dwapple, come out of that cart front and center this instant. Out I say, sir. Florian strode resolutely forward, but the mouse in the blue gown suddenly flung herself dramatically in front of the cart. One paw outstretched, the other across her brow. She declaimed. Oh, Mr. Florian, I beseech you, sir, touch not a hair on that babe's tender head. Do nothing, you will reproach him yourself for the sunlit seasons lying ahead. Hear a pitiful mother's plea, and punish not the harmless innocent. Spare him, I beg of you. Runk-tip, the hedgehog, chortled bitterly as he removed the bunting from his spikes. Drop all a harmless innocent, huh? That un's about as harmless as a bucket of serpents as a sack of stoats, and you ain't his mother, Deesum, you're only his auntie. Deesum shot Runk Tip a haughty glance. A mere detail, do not quibble, sir. No mother could love a babe as I loved Wobble. Come to me, my precious mite. These are such strange names, but they're great. Clambering into the cart, she grabbed a small, fat mouse babe, who wore a stained, oversized smock and a wicked scowl. Hanging from one of his grubby paws was a miniature slingshot. He wriggled and kicked desperately as Deesum smothered him with kisses. Grarg, leg a go, a double, stop a kiss me, blarg. Elichim, the otter, massaged a bruised paw as he glared at the infant. You steaming little nit, Thwapple, you ruined our rehearsal. Florian interrupted sternly. Indeed you have, ye young rip-curdle. Apologize to the entire troop this very flippant instant. Say you're sorry, sir. From over Deesum's shoulder, Dwapple grinned fiendishly at the company. Asagi. The hare squinched his eyes. Squinched is also great. Instead of squinted, squinched. The hare squinched his eyes at Thwapple. Beg pardon, what'd you say? Deesum stamped her paw impatiently. He said he's sorry. Isn't that good enough for you? Would you like the little fellow to shed salt tears and roll in the dust? Isn't the word sorry satisfactory to a heartless driving taskmaster like you? Florian threw his paws up in despair. I suppose it'll have to be what? Deesum patted the little mouse baby's back reassuringly. There now, my little treasure. They're all forgiving you. Isn't that nice? Will you give them all a big kiss? The hedgehog Runk-a-tip backed off with a horrified face. Let that little savage kiss me? No thanks. He'd probably bite the snout off of me. Florian waggled his cane severely at Thwapple. Absolutely no need to go kissing and hugging every beast. Just behave yourself in the future, me laddo, particularly at rehearsals. What? Turning on his heel, the hare strode Grandiloquity. Is that it? Grandiloquity. I swear he's making some of his words up. Off. Only to be hit sharply on his bobtail by a missile from Dwapple's sling. Hawooch. Bandit fiend, polywoggle, scallywag. I'll have to tail you for breakfast. Well, they're introducing, like, a circus troupe, essentially. It's like, these first few chapters are introducing everyone. So the first chapter we had a family of squirrels, and they were attacked by the Marl Foxes, and then they decide we're going to Redwall Abbey, which is, like, a big church, to go warn them. And I'm assuming this, chapter two, it's a circus group, and I'm assuming they're headed to Redwall to perform, so, as well. Yowooch, bandit, fiend, polywaggle, scallywag, I have to tail you for breakfast, saw. The sight of Florian's enraged face set Thwapple crying in distress. And, so it's the circus and the rehearsing, and this little baby mouse, like, ruined their rehearsal by throwing a slingshot at them. So, that's what's happening, if you are confused. And the circus is run by a hare, and the hares are usually very comedic. Great characters. There's one in Redwall called Basil, and he's great. He's like this, he's trying to be this great military leader, and he's just like ridiculous the entire time. The sight of Florian's enraged face set Thwapple crying in distress. Wah, nasty webbit gonna eat Thwapple's tail. Woohoo! I mean, only lick a baby. Wah wah ha. Like, he writes really strangely. Deesum hugged the mouse babe closer to her as she rounded on Florian. You callous monster, fancy frightening the poor little fellow like that? Florian hung his head down and danced upon it. Madam, I'll have you know that wretch shot me in the posterior and called me rabbit to boot. Deesum stamped her paw hard. Enough, one more word, sir, and I'll resign from your troop and take baby Thwapple with me. Roop the mole and his spangled bloomer shook his head dolefully. Grumbling in his curious mole speech, her no look, such look, oin doin, suppose Bruno. Muggle, the other mole, gathered up a pail and trundled down the stream. She wrinkled her velvety snout at her companions. E can stain your arguing all day. Oin going to get big feast vittles readied. Bain't going to wear my joys at all shutting. Florian, who liked to issue all the orders, coughed offishly. Ahem, rather. Just what I was about to suggest myself. Right, troop, breakfast time. Elchim, get a fire going. Runkip, see to the larder. The rest of you, make yourselves busy. What? Quick's the word and sharp's the action. What, what? Runkip spread the meager rations on the bankside, where Muggle was boiling water over the small fire Elchim had kindled. The hedgehog scratched his head spikes. Ain't enough grub to left to keep a fat bumblebee going. Deesum glanced at the two shriveled apples, dandelion stalks, and a stale loaf of rye bread, which had crumbled into pieces, and some half a dozen withered field mushrooms. Oh, seasons of mercy on us, the babe will starve. Ever the optimist, Florian began chopping the scanty provisions up and tossing them into the pail of bubbling water. Nonsense, Marm. Fiddlesticks. Nature's bounty has provided us with sufficient food for a nourishing broth. Let's all eat hearty and looking forward to the better, more prosperous times. What? The soup was dreadful. but knowing there was nothing else, the wandering Noonval companion spooned it down in stoic silence until Runkip began eulogizing on past dishes he had eaten, as hungry hedgehogs will invariably do. Crispy old white bread straight out the oven, that's the stuff. Goes down a treat with some good yellow nut cheese and a young onions fresh picked, all washed down with a foamy beaker of dark ale. Oh, a feast fit for a king, I say. Boracool the otter closed his eyes dreamily. Pippin out scones, matey. Spread with metal cream and serve with wide, fat, juicy strawberries coated in honey, a flagon of cold cider, of course. Now that's a feast fit for a king. Root picked up something dubious out of his soup bowl, wrinkling his nose as he flicked his offending item into the stream. Brrrr. Well, seeing as you two ain't kings, who I don't seen your mouths for eating, and ain't making us any hungrier. The mouse-babed Wobbles picked up his bowl and began twaddling off. Deesum chided her charge brusquely. Dwapple, come back here. Where are you taking that soup? Dwapple nodded to a rock-stern knoll along the stream bank. Ugh, voice cracking. Along the stream bank. This soup not good for babies. Gonna give them to the Foskers. See, you guys see where like this is going here? Elitrim stared at Dwapple quizzically. Foskers? Deesum translated. He means foxes. Florian was immediately on the alert. Foxes? Well, foxes, where? Another pair of marl foxes, identical to the two who had accosted Jangler, rose up from amid the rocks where they had lain watching the companions since dawn. Their names were Geltor and Predak, brother and sister. Seeing they had been spotted, the pair approached the camp boldly, their drab cloaks flapping slightly in the light morning breeze. Boracool cautioned his friends in keeping an eye on the strange pair. Careful, mates. They're carrying axes under their cloaks. Florian stood up. Steady in the ranks, chaps. Leave this to me. I'll do the talking. See those strange markings? I reckon I heard about these creatures, but I never thought I'd have a bad luck to see them for myself. Marl foxes, they're called bad beasts. The foxes stopped a few paces short of the group. Florian walked cautiously out and greeted them. Good day, friends. Beautiful summer morning, Walt. Geltor, the male fox, nodded slightly before speaking. Who are you? Where do you go? Florian bowed eloquently, sweeping off his hat with a flourish. As you can see by our cart, we are the Wandering Noonval Companions, a purely theatrical group of talented creatures. Predak, the female, moved closer to the fire. What's in the pot? Deesum dipped a short curtsy. It's a sort of soupy broth. You're welcome to join us. Predak leaned over the pot and sniffed. She wrinkled her muzzle disgustedly. Slops. Burakel picked up the large pebble and tossed it from paw to paw. No beast forcing you to eat, and you weren't asked to insult it either. Good manners don't cost nothing, fox. Predak's paws edged towards her cloak. Mayhap I'll teach you a few manners, river dog. Florian was quickly between them. Tush and pish, what's all this? Predak drew her paw away from the axe beneath her cloak. You told us who you are, but you never said where you're going. The hare waved a paw airily. Oh, thither. You know thither and yon. A traveling show like ours doesn't actually go anywhere. We roam as the mood takes us. But you, friend, will you tell us your names? Where are you bound on this summer's day? What? The marl fox's pale eyes stared insultantly at the hare. What we are is called is none of your concern, and where we go is no beast's business. Florian Dugglewolf Whiffachop's ears quivered with indignation. So ho, it's bad manners and insults time, is it? Well, listen to me, you pop-belly pickle-nosed louse-bound patch-quilts. You can both take a run and dive into that stream and boil your fat heads, and furthermore, you can take your mange-ridden bodies, hides out of our camp before I assist you in that stout right boot. Good day to you both. Geltor had his axe half drawn when the otter Elchin picked up a thick pole using the balancing act and flicked it in the air in front of the fox's face with it. I wouldn't troll that axe if I were you, matey. These poles cracking heads like it does eggs. Predak found herself facing Boracle, hiding his big pebble, ready to throw him back by two moles brandishing burning sticks from the fire. Runkdick dashed towards the cart and dragged a long, shining sword, a stage prop that bent and flopped out comically. "Now back off, both of ye, or we'll get ready to find out the color of your own insides. Move!" The Marl Foxes knew that they were outflanked and outnumbered, and backed off toward the rocks. Geltor pointed at the troop and snarled. "We'll meet again, but 'twill be different next time." Florian threw the hem of his frock coat across one shoulder and called back in outrageously dramatic voice, "Indeed it will be different. This land will be rid of you two rogues the next time we cross paths. Mock me, words, you spotty villains." Predak pointed beyond the troop and shouted, "We're not the only two here. There are others behind you." The entire troop turned and scanned the landscape. After a moment or two, Florian scoffed. "Not an earthly sight of any beast. What do they think we are to fall for that? A bunch of oats, what?" When they turned back again, the two Marl Foxes had vanished into thin air. Florian sighed. "Wish we could learn that trick. Ah well, comrades, onward ever, onward." Deesum was still looking about fearfully. Onward to where? For the great florist, the hare clicked the cooking pot over, letting the meager broth spill into the stream. "Why, onward to Redwall Abbey, of course, me dear. Where else?" "See, I knew it. They're going to Redwall. That's where they always go." Roop chuckled and rubbed his stomach gleefully. "Hoy! Oh, dearly loves we victuals at Redwall Abbey." Florian issued the orders. "Attention, troop! Load up the carts. Burkle, Elichim, and the shafts, please. Tip, you and I will walk behind, armed with poles to protect our rear. The rest of you ride in the cart. We must get the news to Redwall. There are Marl Foxes in the land." As late morning heat shimmered on the flatlands and grasshoppers chirped dryly beneath the hot summer sun, the cart trundled off towards Moss Flower Wood with the entire company singing. "Oh, for the open road, no dullard's life for me. The world is my abode, performing endlessly. I'm free, companions, we travel the highways happily, performing deeds of daring do and plays of heroes good and true. Tumbling, singling, in merry attire, pray tell me, sir, what you desire? Come fiddly, dumb, twiddly, dee. Derry down day, a harum, scrubble, hobble, wee. Come one, come all, this day, the sea, the wandering new vow company." And E is like really, it's like a. You can see that. Like, look at that E. Company. At the very heart of Moss Flower Country, the vastness of lordly wide trunk trees gave way to an expansive water meadow, formed in a wide shallow basin at the juncture of two streams. Mid-afternoon heat haze shimmered on the far margin of Logalog. The chieftain of the Goysum stood waist-deep at the fringe of the tall reeds with his shrews. Now, Logalog's in a lot of these books. He's like this shrew captain. He's always, and they always, like, they chant lug a lug a lug a lug a lug a lug a lug, and I see that on this page actually coming. But they would always chant it, like these fucking. So imagine like these little shrews, and they're like very feisty, and that's what they shout. Mid-afternoon heat haze shimmered on the far margin of Lug a Lug. Chieftain of the Goysum stood waist deep at the fringe of the tall reeds with the shrews. Though usually a loud argumentative band, the guerrilla union of shrews and Mossflower were unusually quiet. Each small, scruffy furred fighter, equipped with a vari-colored headband and a short rapier, watched their leader as he parted bulrush and marshwort. Raising himself on tip-paw, Lug-a-Lug shaded his eyes, peering out above the reaches of the water lily, crowfoot, and brookweed. A large striped dragonfly hovered near the shrew chieftain's face, investigating him. He growled at it. "Buzz off!" Surprisingly, it did. He watched a brown trout fin idly by him, just beneath the surface. Lug-a-Lug wished that he could forget his tribe's troubles and go fishing. Behind him, a young shrew chewed noisily at some watercress, and Lug-a-Lug turned and fixed him with a severe stare. The young Goysum shrew stopped chirping and swallowed guiltily. An older shrew pointed out Lug-a-Lug's shoulder. Over there, chief. Uncle Lug's eyes narrowed as he turned and stared searchingly over the sun-still reaches of the water meadow. Over at the eastern edge, by a stand of weeping willows, an oar poked itself in the air, waving back and forth thrice. He cupped both paws around his mouth and let forth a long, mutilating call. Lugga 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 law. Immediately, the shrews behind him relaxed and began chattering. That'll be Bargle and the others. Then the coast meb will be clear, eh? Well, the chief wouldn't have caught it if he was a stumpin'. Lugalug followed as they waded back on the dry ground, still disputing and debating. Stump it yourself, Wobble Snout, or you know it ain't still around. Wobble Snout, listen, matey, if I had a snout like yours, I'd be good gulp down snout about the others. That's how they talk. Maybe Bargle was alone. The others might have been ambushed. Nah, Splicker with him. He won't let himself get ambushed. Oh, wouldn't he then? Remember that time by the South Rapids? Sturdy Gavin, lost your lips, mate. May on see the vittles. Lugalug stamped upon the bank, shaking water from himself. The shrews were seated in a circle three deep when Bargle and his scouts came in. Lugalug mentioned them to sit and help themselves to a beaker of rough cider each and some wedges of white celery cheese with shrew bread. When they were comfortably settled and eating, Bargle made his report. We saw the two marl foxes just afore noon, chief, west of here. Eye of a wide string. Then they vanished right before our eyes. Lugalug undid his shoulder belt and let his rapier fall to the ground, rubbing the back of his paw wearily across his eyes. No sign of those rats on our log boats, I suppose. The shrew named Splicker shrugged. Never saw them. But we tracked their sign. We bound west at South Point, chief. By the seasons they can paddle boats as well as any shrew, believe me. Lugalug shook his head despairingly. Stands to reason, doesn't it? They're water rats. Western point to south, you say? Aye, chief. But there's a lot of them, so logboats can be overloaded. I saw keels scrapping in the shallows that can't be traveling very fast, weighted down as they are. Lug drained his beaker and sat a while, gnawing wordily in his lip. The gruesome watched in silence until a scuffle broke out behind his back. Lug rolled around in time to see a hulkling shrew dealing the young one who had been eating the watercress a hefty blow. As the shrew fell back holding his face, the hefty one began to kick him, rumbling bad-temperedly. It was you, Dippler, sleeping on guard while those foxes and rats stole the boats from under your nose, you worthless tail dragon. Lugalug was up in a flash, launching himself sideways. He caught the hefty one a flying double kick to the stomach, sending him sprawling. The chieftain stood over him, quivering in anger. Lay a paw near Dipper again, and I'll bore your guts to your backbone if that's if you have any. Yeah, he's British. Brian Jacques was British. He's also dead. Unfortunately. May he rest in peace. The hefty shrew, who was called Fenno, glared up at his chief with eyes filled with unspoken rage. Lugalug was older, smaller, and lighter than him, but he was not chieftain for nothing. Lugalug smiled, nodding back to his rapier on the ground. Come on, Fenno, you're a big beast, carrying a blade too. I'm not armed, but if you figure you're brave enough to carry out the beatings in this tribe, why not try me? Come on, mate, let's see what you're made of. There was a tension in the air as Goosen watched both shrews. Then Fenno, still laying flat, placed a paw across his eyes, a sign of submission. A few chuckles broke out from the Goosen. Oh, Fenno did the sensible thing there, mate. Aye, so he did. No beast messes with Lugalug. Leastways, no beast that wants to grow old in one piece. Lugalug helped Dipper lure up. Throwing a paw around the youngster's shoulders, he gestured for silence. Hearken now. I don't want any shrew complaining about young Dippler or trying to roughen him up. We was all young and once, and we all make mistakes. Some of them were worse than others. Dippler slept on guard and lost our longboats, all six of them. Good craft, too, they were. So the young'un will learn better. He'll try harder. You will, won't you, matey? Dippler wiped mud from his bruised face. Smiling through his tears. I won't let the goysum down ever again, chief. That's a promise. Lugalug patted Dippler's back heartily. Good fella. Now, goysum is the bad news. Those boats of ours can only go one way on the wide stream, and that way takes them too close to Redwall Abbey to my liking. I know we ain't used to walking, but we've got to let the Abbey. We've got to get to the Abbey and warn them. I never saw water rats and mossflower before, and I know that their leaders, those marl foxes, are evil beasts. Magic, too. They've got tools, wood, and carpenters at the Abbey, so the sooner we're there, the quicker we'll get new boats built. Right? The bass voice shrews roared back with agreement. Right. Lugalug smiled as he buckled his rapier back on. So what are you sitting around like a crowd of butterflies with wet wings for? Let's get tromping. They formed up into six lines, one for the crew of each boat. As they marched away, Bargle clawed out a Lugalug. I know we aren't sailing, Chief, but we could sing a paddle song to help us paddle step on the way. Lugalug nodded and roared out a fast paddle song with the rest of the as they stamped away through the dim aisles of Mossflower. Wum chucka chucka wum chucka chucka wum. Goysome dig your paddle deep. Her boldly river wide and curly, there's no time to sleep. Wum chucka om chucka 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 wum. Rapid wild and fast you go. Hurly burly river quirly whirl. Bend your becks and row. Wum chucka 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 wum. Keep her bows up in the foam. Hurly burly river wide and curly. Longboat take us home. Rum chaka chaka cha. The rousing boat song echoed through the wooded glades and grassy clearings as Lugalug and his Goysome shrews marched to Redwall. And that's chapter 2. So you guys have any questions so far? Thank you. I wish I could, I'm trying to assign each character a different voice, but then I kind of forget which one I assigned it. So, kind of going with, like, a generic one for each, in a way. Although, I'll try and keep the, like, if I know they're the foxes, I'll try and talk sinisterly over, like, the others. For now. I know the Lugalugs are kind of like, you know, barbarian types in a way. Yeah, Juan, he definitely writes tongue twisters in the books. Some of the words he like makes up, and they're not easy to read aloud. I gotta use the bathroom. And I'll be right back. Yeah, I like the hair a lot. I usually do like the hairs. Yeah, get some sleep, Allie. Good night. Thanks for stopping by. Good to have you here. I think I'll do one more chapter and call it a night. So, V4 and Y, if you want to hang around for that. Or do you want me to call it a night? What do you guys think? I'm currently scratching the shit on my leg. Feels good, though. That itchiness. Yeah, I could do one more. I could end it here. I do like doing this though, so I think I'll do it again at some point. Maybe we'll slowly get through Marvel Fox. I'll be right back again. This other candy cake. Scratch my nose. Oh. I got like a really nice microphone here, but I don't know if I can hook it up to the computer. It's one that we use for, like when I film. I mean, I can stick around and do one more chapter, Juan, if you want me to. Let me do one more. Do story time nights. I kind of like that. When everyone's not streaming and they're ready to go to sleep, we'll do some story times. I'm really liking this lighting. I try not to be too, vain. But after that, I think I actually look okay in lighting. Less monstrous under my hair. My hair doesn't even look that bad here. Enough of that. Alright, we'll do one more. This is a little bit of a longer chapter. But I believe this is their finally, they got the red wall. Or this one, is set in Redwall, from Redwall's perspective. Like, this is teaching me something about writing already, and, like, I don't know. Like I said, I've been reading a lot of, comics, so I kind of forget basic writing things. Like, it's easier to really make a story better by telling it from all the different perspectives. And, yeah, that's good. Especially for children's writing. Three viewers. Alright, yeah, we'll keep, we'll do one more. This is chapter 3. and a little squirrel. That's Friar Buddy. And he's a squirrel. So, chapter 3. Extract from the writings of old Friar Buddy, squirrel recording of Redwall Abbey in Mossflower Country. So, as I said before, Redwall is a church, essentially. It's like this big abbey that they all live in. And a lot of the stories, like, this is the Redwall series, so everything takes place in, or around, or regarding Redwall. I had a twinge in my left footpaw a moment back. I hope that's a sign of rain. We certainly could do with a good shower. Everything seems to be drooping or wilting. Badger Mums Krega says 'tis the driest season she's ever known, and she's seen more summers than the rest of us put together. Redwallers have had to form a chain from the abbey pond to the orchard, bringing pails of water to the thirsty trees and vines that produce our fruits and berries. A pity we haven't been able more bodied creatures. Redwall seems to be populated by the elders or the very young these last few seasons. I can remember the times when Abbess Tansy ruled. There seemed to be no end of willing otters, moles, mice, squirrels, and hedgehogs to perform the daily chores of Redwall. But that was a long time back, when I served as an assistant cook in the kitchens under old mother Buskell. Who would have thought the days would arrive when I would be called old? Yes, old Friar Buddy, that's me, too old to cook and far too rheumatically to serve as abbot. Even there was a time where every beast seemed to be keep asking me to take up the position. 'Tis a sad reflection, Redwall Abbey without an abbot or abbess, but that's the way things are this season. Poor old Arvin, who was once abbey warrior, served as abbot for 3 seasons after Abbess Tansy had gone to her rest. Unfortunately, he passed on to sunlit pastures during the spring, having survived a rough winter. So now there is only myself and Badger Mum Krega, with the good mouse Sister Slowey running the infirmary, Triglow Spearback, our hedgehog cellar keeper Diggum and Golem, his mole helpers, and Gubbio, who is now a four mole. All that is left of our old friends, the sword of Martin, our founder and first abbey warrior, hangs on the walls in Krega's room. His brave guiding spirit is blended into the ancient red sandstone of our beautiful abbey. Seasons have been kind, and peace has reigned here many, many summers. I think it is to thanks the spirit of Martin. Oh, I forgot one other thing, still here from the old days. In fact, I can see him now from the gatehouse window where I am sitting. Nutwing the Owl. He was one of the 3 born here at Redwall. His brother and sister have long flown off, but Nutwing has stayed and remained faithful to the abbey. He is, how shall I put it, an unwise old owl, having great lapses of memory in his later seasons. You will pardon me, I'm sure, but I feel I'm about to be lured away from my recording duties. I just hope 'tis nothing strenuous. He has no idea, right? It's fucking great. The owl waddled upright to the gatehouse window and peered in through tiny, thick, crystal-lens spectacles perched on his beak curve. Huh? Huh? Is that you, buddy? The old squirrel poked his head out the window, facing Nutwing nose to beak. Who else would it be, pushing a quill pen instinct paws buried among scrolls on a beautiful summer morn like this? Certainly not yourself, you feathered old fraud. Nutwing shook his head absently. Huh? Huh? No, it wouldn't be me. Not like writing one little bit. Do you think it likely rains soon? Buddy nodded toward the hot blue cloudless sky. I have 1 paw twinge today, but that could mean nothing. Look up and tell me what you think. Nutwing flapped his wings resignedly. Sky is too far up for me to see. I don't bother with it. Friar Buddy came around outside the gatehouse to where the owl stood. Well, friend, I'm sure you didn't come this far just to chat about the weather. What do you want? Nutwing thought long and hard, blinking and moving his head from side to side. Let me see. Was it something to do with? No, that wasn't it. Perhaps it was. No. I forgot about that. Buddy smiled indulgently. Was it anything to do with strawberries, perhaps? Nutwing looked astonished. How did you know? Because when he flapped your wings, a strawberry fell out on the grass. There it is. It was a giant of a fruit, shiny red, plumped and speckled with seeds. Nutwing grinned heavily. Retrieving the strawberry, he gave it to the squirrel. I brought this beauty over for you, friend. They're taking the berries to the kitchen, and your advice is needed. Friar Buddy bit into the fruit, wiping juice from his whiskers as he chewed. Oh, delicious. I hope they're all the same quality as this. What a wonderful thing a strawberry is. It has a flavor and a fragrance all of its own. The taste of a good summer. Right. Let's go to the kitchens and see how I can be of help. Badgermum Craiga was totally blind, though it did not seem to hamper her greatly. She waited at the Abbey's main door to greet the pair. Ah, well done, Nutwing. You remembered your errand. Come on, buddy, finish eating that strawberry and get along to the kitchens. The old friar was amazed, but how did you... Redwall's blind Badgermum forestalled the questions. I know 'tis you, because you limp a bit on that remick paw, and any creature with a half a nose and one ear can tell by the aroma and sound of chomping when some beast is enjoying a big strawberry. Now hurry along before the Dibbons decide what to do with the entire crop. Gubbio Formal and Sister Slowey had their paws full, trying to control the greedy Abbey babes and the Dibbons from ravaging the baskets of fruit when they piled up from everywhere around the kitchens. Yurr, you my rascal, get them your paws out your basket. Formal lifted a tiny mouse down from the shelf top where she was rummaging in the basket to find the biggest berries. Sister Slowey menaced two small moles who were stained from ear to smock with crimson juice, shaking a wooden spoon at them as they stuffed strawberries in their mouths with both paws. Another one, do you hear me? Stop immediately. Through a mouthful of the fruit of the mole babes, explained patiently to the infirmary sister why they had to complete their self-appointed task. Nay, marm, lessons to be only eaten the ones that go bad soon. Her and the job and for looks is out for the infants. The sister did not share their viewpoint. The only things that'll go bad are your tummies. You'll be sick as stuffed frogs, a pair of you. Now stop at this instant. All the Dibbons froze as Craig's voice boomed severely through the kitchens. Just point out any Dibbons who've been pinching strawberries and I'll deal with them. By the thundering seasons of strife, I will. The mole babe Wugger tugged Friar Buddy's habit cord and whispered, Yours or Buddy, don't you tell Badger Mum we be pinching strawberries and won't you tell no one. The old friar winked secretly at Wugger and spoke out loud. Craiga, marm, how could you say such things? I'm sure none of the Dibbons would be villainous as such that pinch strawberries. They're merely helping to carry them and then sack the baskets. A cry of agreement burst from the Dibbons. Yes, friar be right, marm. Us and good in one's beasts. No pinching no strawberries, not never. Craiga nodded solemnly. Well, I'm very glad to hear it, because once many seasons before any of you were born, we had a Dibbon at Redwall who... And do you remember what happened to him, Sister Slowey? Slowey pursed her lips forbiddingly as she continued the tale. Oh, I recall that one right enough. He ate strawberries from dawn to dusk on the day of the harvest, never listened to a word when he was told to stop. Kept on pinching and scoffing all the biggest and juicy ones. Guess what happened to him as he was on the stairs of the dormitory? Slowey glazed at the wide-eyed Dibbons, hanging on to her every word. Suddenly, she clapped her paws sharply and shouted. He went bang! Just like that, exploded, and he was never seen again. Isn't that right, Friar Buddy? The old squirrel nodded sadly. Aye, that's what happened, sister. You can still see the red mark he left halfway up the stairs. Poor, greedy little mite. Shocked and horrified, Dibbons unloaded strawberries from their smock pockets back into the basket, stunned by the fate of the gluttonous Dibbon in that far-gone season. Then they rushed from the kitchen, squeaking and shouting as they headed to the dormitory stairs, where the incident was reputed to have taken place. Minute they had gone, Craigan popped a strawberry into her mouth, chuckling. Ha ha, that story works every summer. I wonder what the bright red mark on the stairs is, though. It feels quite smooth, probably a lump of quartz in the stone. Nutwing watched Craigan feel around the basket besides her for another large strawberry. I've seen it. A bit too big for a Dibbon. Must have been a greedy badger who wouldn't stop pinching strawberries, eh? I guess these are educational streams before. Triglow Spearbuck. Spearback, the cellar keeper, an immense hedgehog, lumbered in. Stuffing both paws into his wide canvas pocket, he grinned and winked at Nutmeg. Aye, mayhaps 'twas a badger. Now then, old Betty, which ones are mine? Make sure they are good and juicy, enough for the brew in a barrel of strawberry fizz. Friar Buddy did his rounds at the basket, sniffing and prodding gently at the fruit contained and marking certain ones with a charcoal stick. There should be enough for you, Triglow, a dozen good baskets. Sister Sloby, you take this one to sweeten up those herb potions you give the sick Dibbins. And Brother Meliot? A fat dormouse emerged from an unlit oven, scrubbing brush and pail in his paws. That's the last time I let moles make dancing jam in my oven. Sticks like glue when it bubbles over. Did you want me, Friar? Buddy indicated the unmarked baskets. These are all for you. What'd you plan on making? Strawberry tarts? Obviously. I noticed a pot of red currant jelly cooling on the windowsill as I came in. Meliot took off his greasy apron and began tying a freshly laundered one. Strawberry tarts for sure, with a good short crust pastry and lots of whipped middle cream on top. I'll probably do some strawberry and pear flans too, and a big strawberry trifle if that you'll be good enough to help me with, Friar. Buddy agreed willingly. Oh yes, a big extra trifle with plums and raspberries in it too. Every beast began contributing it ideas what made the perfect trifle. And lots of flaked almonds and hazelnuts sprinkled on top. Aye, and with a good beaker of elderberry pie wine mixed in. Be sure to set it in blackberry jelly, with lots of honey sponges slices to make it nice and soggy. Sweet arrowroot custard, good and deep. Brr, and gurglubbets and clotted middle green on top of that. The discussion was interrupted when a stocky older squirrel strode in, and a younger one in his wake, both carrying pails in either paw. The older squirrel, Russell, was obviously hot and rather irritated. Any beast interested in lending a paw to fetch water from the pond for the orchard out there? Seems there's only me and my son left to do it. Craigett placed a paw across her bow. Oh, I'm sorry, Russell. I meant to send Nutwing over to tell you the orchard's been watered enough for the day. Nutwing smiled behind his pebble-thick glasses. I'm glad I'm not the only creature who forgets things. Russell had been at Redwall less than 3 seasons. He had been a wanderer and a warrior, but when his wife died, he came to stay at Redwall, bringing with him his son Danflor, a quiet young squirrel. Both were strong and good warriors, but Russell has changed since the death of his wife. He was no longer the happy-go-lucky creature of former days. He was often quick to take offense and sometimes difficult to get on with. He nodded at the creatures assembled in the kitchen, then turned to Danflor. Let's put these pails away and get washed up before lunch, son. Outside the abbey pool seemed to cool Russell down a bit. Danflor washed his paws in silence, watching his father sluice water across his face with both paws, blowing up and snorting as he entered his nostrils. Danflor glanced up at the sky. Wish it rained, then be no need to carry water, eh? Russell wriggled a paw in one ear to get the water out. Aye, son. Wouldn't it be a bad idea for some beast to tell us the orchard had enough water and all? Danflor shrugged good-naturedly. It's not the badger mum's home, she forgot. She carried as much water as both of us earlier on. Yeah, his food descriptions are incredible. I remember being 12 and his website had like the recipes and I made a bunch of them and they were so fucking good, like so sweet. I wonder if that's still out there somewhere. I'm sure it is. Like, Redwall recipes for stuff. And I only made the simple ones back then, because I was just, like, you know, I was young. So, I'm sure I can make more difficult ones now. Which could be tasty. Russell nodded grudging agreement. Maybe she did, but this place needs a leader, an Abadar and Abbas. I liked old Abbot Arvin. When he was alive, things seemed much to run smoother. Danflor dried his paws on the grass. That's because Arvin was a warrior one time, just like you. Probably the reason you got on so well together. Russell smiled one of his rare smiles and flicked a pebble at his son. True enough, Dan. Me and you are the only warriors left in Redwall, and we all get well enough, don't we? Danflor caught the pebble and skimmed it over the pond. Of course we get on, because I'm your son and you're my dad. I've never been in a fight or seen battle, so you couldn't really call me a warrior. and I was only a dipping before we came here, you know. Russell's eyes hardened. He took his son's paw and held it tight. But you are a warrior, Danflor. I know it. The blood of warriors runs in your veins. Never forget that, son. They rose together and walked toward the orchard, where lunch was being served in the shade of the trees. Danflor paced easily beside his father. But Redwall Abbey is the most peaceful place a creature could wish to be. How will I know when I become a warrior? Russell stopped and stared at him. Your name is Danflor Ruguba. In ancient squirrel language, the Ruguba was the greatest warrior in all the lands. I am called Ruguba as my father was before me. When danger threatens you to face the foe beast, then you will know you are Ruguba, bravest of the brave. Lunch was a fairly simple one. Sliced fruits, apple, pear, greengage, and plum. Some fresh baked scones and damson jam and the dandelion and boardock cordial foamy and cold from Triglo Cellar Hog's vaults. Russell sat chatting with Triglo when Danflor chose to sit next to Krega. The badger mom reached out the huge paw and rubbed it gently over his face. You are troubled, Dan. What's going on in that mind of yours? The young squirrel sucked foam noisily from the top of his beaker. Not so much troubled as puzzled, Marm. They say you were once a great warrior. My father likes the companies of warriors, but he never seems to talk at any length with you. Why is that? Krega shrugged lightly, her blind eyes facing straight ahead. Probably because I never talk about my seasons as a fighter. That is all in the dead past to me. Peace and this beautiful abbey are what matter to me in my life now. Do you like Redwall, Dan? Aye, I like it a lot. It is really home to me. Krega smiled and nodded her great striped head. Good. 'Tis my home, too, though I've never seen it with my eyes. I was blown into battle before I ever arrived at Redwall. Do me a favor, Dan. Look at it and tell me what you see. You can be my eyes. Go on. Let's see if we both live in the same place. Danflor held the blind battered mom's paw as he spoke. A path runs from the north to the south, and Redwall stands by the side of it. Mossflower wood grows from the north and the east walls, partially on the south. A big main threshold gate faces the path with a gatehouse just inside. The little outer walls are high, thick and solid, built from the old red sandstone, like the rest of the abbey. Battlements and a wide wall top run outside the outer walls, making it like a safe fortress. Inside there are gardens and lawns and a pond and this orchard. But in the middle of it all stands the abbey. It is a huge old building, very high, with a meadow vane on top of a great long roof. The marvelous stained glass windows, great arches and columns. Built against one side is a bell tower with two bells inside, which are tolled at dawn, midday, twilight, and softly at midnight. I like the bells. They have a warm, friendly sound, as if they're watching over us. Krega squeezed the young crow's paw gently. You have a good eye and a kind heart, Danflor. Your picture of our abbey is the same one I carry in my imagination. While they had been talking, the sky was starting to cloud over the southeast, gradually at first, but the clouds increased as the breeze sprang up to drive, then along, blotting out the blue summer noon. Friar Buddy felt his footfall twinge again. Ha! I knew it! We'll have rain before long, friends. Splot! Splat! Two large raindrops hit the leaves of a plum tree, one of them rolling down to burst on four more Gobio's nose. Yay, rain bite awaiting on your word, buddy. He'd be writing right now. As the wolf spoke, long-awaited rain came splattering and battering down, a proper summer storm, driven sideways on the wind. Thunder rumbled afar with a distant lightning flash flaring briefly in the east. Dust turned immediately to mud. Dry, yellow grass was flattened against the wet earth, and a tremendous din of countless large drops pattering against foliage and wrapping upon tree trunks as it hissed the abbey, virtually drowned out all other sound. Brother Melliot and Russell swooped the linen spread off the ground and knotted it loosely in a large sack with foodstuff and dishes inside. They bore it between them to the abbey. Craig of Badgemon boomed over the din. Every beast inside, ambling sideways, she shielded many elders and young ones with her bulk. Sister slowly tugged at Triglo's apron, rain pouring down her face and the open mouth as she called to him. Mr. Triglo, those two divins not here. Danflor joined them, his fur plastered flat by the downpour. That'll be two mole babes, Marm. Wogel and Blinny. They went off to the gatehouse as my father and I were coming up from the pond. Trego Spearback shooed Sister Lovell. You get yourselves inside, Marm. Me and Young and Dan will find him. Danflor and Tragolo dashed down the across the lawns, heads down, footballs sloshing and slapping through the wet grass. As the thunder boomed closer and a great porker jagged, lightning rent the sky asunder. Both creatures were driven flat against the gatehouse wall by the wind, and stood there a moment, regaining their breath before fighting their way to the gatehouse door. It was flapping back and forth, for Buddy had it open, and they hurried on inside out of the storm. Tragolo cast a quick eye about. Little rascals, they ain't here, Dan, and we never passed them on the way here. The young squirrel wiped rain from his eyes on the window curtain top. Let's think. I know. Maybe they're on the well top. Dibbins are always told not to go up there, so that's likely where they ought to be. Cheating rain swept the rampits, dancing across the stones and gurgling noisily out of the small downspout so heavy the visibility was virtually nil. Tragolo and Danflor were running almost double past the north battlements when a peal of thunder exploded with frightening force directly overhead, and the crackle of chain lightning that followed the hedgehog pointed to the northeast gamble end, and the two small figures huddled there. Horror, there they be. It was hard to imagine two more saturated and frightened little creatures. The mole babes wailed and threw themselves at the rescuers. Wah! Us'n's be girtly drowned, zers! Tragolo untied his stout canvas apron and placed it over the Dibbins, and between them and Danflor picked them up and started down the east wall steps, watching carefully where they trod as the steps were awash. Reaching the lawn, they skirted the rear of the abbey, almost blown around the corner of the bell tower by the increasing wind. Wugger and Blinny held tight to the canvas apron, covering them as it ballooned and flapped. More thunder banged sharply overhead, and lightning sheeted the scene, illuminating it momentarily in an eerie white flash. Craig and Slowly were waiting at the door, holding it open against the weather's onslaught when the four of them rushed inside, breathless and bedraggled. Sister Slowly gave Danflor and Tragolo a towel apiece. You found them, thank goodness, where were they? The hedgehog rubbed vigorously at his face. Just where you'd expect the rogues to be. Sister, top of the blooming wall in the northeast corner, wetting and wetter. Wetter than water weed, I'm telling you to be safe from a drowning. Anyways, they're safe now. As the little group passed through the great hall, more lightning flashed outside, throwing cascades of bright pattern from the colored stained glasses on the worn stone floor. A fire was burning in the cavern hall where all the red wallers were gathered, towels flapping wetly and steam rising from the damp fur. Sister Slytherin, Gorbol, Cellar Mole dried the two Dibbins off, none too gently. Wugger's head shook from side to side as Sister rubbed it scolding. Time and time again you've been told not to go up on the wall top to play, so what were you two doing up top of there? Speak up. Hurry nothing's on no talking to the funny beast in the woods, Marm. Funny beasts? What funny beasts? There were two of them, Marm, and they were in black and blue and wartin' cloakers. Danflor had trouble keeping a straight face. Wugger was obviously making up some sort of story that justifies visits to the wall top. Two funny creatures. All white and black and blue wearing great cloaks. What did you say to them? Austin didn't say naught. The air masking of could come down like a little wall gate form. What would you say? Horison will go to and when rain come. Then we saw two fighting a move. What happened to the two funny beasts? Wugger spread his paws and blinked. They're not gone. Just a vanished like that, Zor. Danforth smiled and winked at Tragolo, who nodded understandingly in the mole babe as if it all made sense. All right there, Wugger. The two funny beasts just vanished, you say? Wugger nodded, his little face completely serious. Aye, Zor, that's right. Sister slowly wagged a severe paw under his nose. You've eaten too many strawberries and made yourself ill. Straight up the bed, both of you, young mole, you too, Blinny. Both of you had quite enough for one day, pinching strawberries, playing on that wall in the thunderstorm, and telling a pack of fibs. Now, not another peep out of either of you. Straight upstairs this instant. Looking the picture of detection, the two tiny moles, fur standing up from their toweling, were led off to the dormitories by Sister Slowly. Friar Buddy smiled at Nutwing. Black, white, and blue creatures with great cloaks that vanished in the thin air. What to think of next? The owl dried his spectacles on the towel corner. I blame the elders, not telling tales of strawberry thieves who went bang and were never seen again for this red, save for a red patch on the stairs. Little wonder that Dibbins grew up telling fibs after hearing tales like that. Outside, the mid-afternoon resembled the night as the storm roared around Redwall Abbey, lashing its ancient stones and causing the moss-flowered treetops to sway wildly in its grip. Snug inside in their comfortable abbey, the creatures of Redwall, now warm and dry, took to ease and safety and calm. Is the hedgehog a redneck? I don't know. They all talk weird. That was chapter 3. So shit is going to be hitting the fan at Redwall. Their peace is going to be soon, like, just completely and utterly fucked. I guess I shouldn't really curse, because kids might actually be looking up this. So, I'll try not to curse next time. Not that kids are probably watching this whole thing this long, but... like, if I was a kid... and we had YouTube when I was young, I probably would have been looking up the books to see if anyone's reading them. My apologies, kids. Yeah, so, those were the first three chapters. Maybe I'll continue another time. I don't know. But, I'll call it a night here. Thanks for sticking around on in V4. And for everyone that was here earlier. And I hope you all have a good night. And... see you around.